Revelry Cycles here in beautiful Sydney, Australia. Thank you so much for subscribing and commenting and sharing our videos. We're shocked and completely impressed with how well everything is going. So thanks so much for engaging with us. We're really grateful for that. Today's video is going to be all about cams and compression. But first, I wanted to answer a question we've been getting a lot, maybe the most frequent question, and that is about our accents or lack thereof accents. We live in Australia. We're actually American. We've been here since 2004, so that's why we don't sound like an Aussie. So the other thing we wanted to tell you is that in all of our descriptions in the videos now, we're going to be adding timestamps because we understand our videos are a lot of information. They're not short clips. And so we just want to make it easier for you to sort of skip ahead to the part that interests you, or if you want to go back and rewatch something, that should make it a little bit easier. Yeah. So the other thing is we've got a secret, and if you stick around till the end, we're going to let you know what that is. Today we have cams, as I mentioned. There's going to be a lot of technical terms, and you're going to need at least a fundamental understanding of how a four-stroke engine works. So we will again add a link in the description to a video that will explain that, and that'll just stop us from having to define everything as we go forward because our videos are long enough. So today we are getting into your engine's valve train. The valve train is made up of the camshaft, sprocket, chain tensioner, the rocker arms, the valve, which is inside the spring there, the spring. Now these are just lightweight springs that we use for checking clearances, not like the heavy duty ones that are actually installed in an engine. The spring seat, the collar, and then the keepers. And the way that this works is as your cam rotates, it puts pressure on the rocker arm. The rocker arm opens the valve, and as it continues to rotate, that spring pressure closes the valve. So that's it. That's as easy as it is. Cam spins around, opens the valves, springs close the valves.
Let's have a look at camshaft design. The components of a camshaft are first the journal. The journals are just what supports the cam and the cylinder head. Then you have lobes, both intake and exhaust. The lobes are responsible for controlling the opening and closing of the valves. A lobe has a heel or a base circle. That's where the valve is closed. Then as the crankshaft rotates around, the lobe controls when the valve opens with a ramp. You have a ramp for opening and for closing, and between the opening and closing ramps, you have a peak or nose for the cam. So it really is the timing and controlling the timing of all those events. When the valves open, how long they stay open, how far they open, when they're both open together, overlap, all of those things are where the magic happens.
Okay, so what are your high performance options for a cam in your Royal Enfield Twin? Today, your choices are the S&S cam or the S&S cam. That's it. This is the only option that we have. It's a really good option. This is a beautiful camshaft. It is machined out of billet, but the magic, as Will would say, or the secret sauce, is right here in these cam lobes. These lobes decide when the valves open, how far they open, how long they open, and when they close. It also determines how long the intake and exhaust valves are open at the same time, or the overlap, right? So their relationship to each other. The S&S cam and stock cam specs are gonna be in the description below because it would be murder for me to read that off to you. And we have included valve lift, which we've not been able to find published anywhere. So we measured it and we'll put that in the description below.
What's involved in the installation of an S&S camshaft? Well, we're not going to do a detailed how to install a cam video because frankly, that's already been done. And also because the reality is this is not something you want to do in your brother-in-law's shed. This is something that you want somebody that's very adept at engine building involved in. The reason for that is first, The S&S cam comes with a valve spring shim that is required to increase the pressure that the spring puts on the valve and the rocker arm to make it more closely follow the cam at higher speeds to prevent valve float. So you definitely don't want to put in an S&S cam without one of these, and installing these requires removal of the valve springs. The instructions specify that to do that, you remove the cylinder head and use a valve spring compressor to take those springs on and off. When you remove the cylinder head, you are then going to need a cylinder head gasket, because those you don't reuse. You're going to need a set of cylinder studs, because these are, Royal Enfield specifies these as the stretch to torque type. So they're a one use only. So you need a new set of cylinder studs. And 99% of the time when you try to remove this cylinder head, there are dowels between the cylinder head and the cylinder, and dowels between the cylinder and the crankcase. And almost always, as you try to lift the cylinder head off this cylinder, those dowels are going to hold in place and you're going to end up rocking this cylinder on the crankcase. When that happens, you break the gasket. So now you've got to remove the cylinder altogether to put a new gasket on. So it can get a lot more involved than just a quick cam job. You'll also need a set of new exhaust gaskets for reference, because when you pull the exhaust system off, trying to reuse these exhaust gaskets is a pretty tough thing to do. Given all that, it does make a lot of sense if you're going to pull the cylinder head off, and you're going to end up pulling the cylinder off the pistons anyway, at that point, you're really only half an hour and a set of pistons from going ahead and installing high compression pistons. Now, why would I want high compression pistons? Well, you'll notice that all of the big bore kits come with 11:1 compression pistons, and the stock compression on the Royal Enfield Twin is 9.5. That extra 0.5 of compression makes a big difference. And if you're in there already and you've got the cylinder base broken loose, it makes sense to just put a set of high compression pistons in, because the high compression pistons will absolutely enable that cam to make more torque lower in the RPM range, as well as more horsepower higher up. Now, experienced engine builders have been replacing valve springs without removing the cylinder head for years. However, it is a fairly complex procedure that's got to be executed with the utmost care. It's very easy to make a mistake that then forces you to remove the cylinder head and do a repair anyway. We have developed a process and the tooling required to do these S&S cams without removing the cylinder head. So the labor to fit a cam without removing the cylinder head is about 3 hours, which means you save the price of cylinder studs, gaskets, and about an hour, hour and a half in labor. So it's really worth taking your bike to a pro to have this done. All right, at the end of the day, what can I expect from my S&S camshaft and my 650? Well, the S&S cam, even in a 650 with just an air cleaner and exhaust, builds a nice broad torque curve and holds that torque much higher in the RPM range. If you use it in a bigger bore, higher compression motor, it builds that torque much earlier. It peaks very quickly and holds the torque right out past the original red line. It absolutely can be run safely in a 650 with just an air cleaner and mufflers, even without a tuner. It will work just fine, and our experience is that combination, air cleaner, mufflers, and a cam in a 650 with a standard compression can net you 6 to 8% increase in horsepower, which is pretty respectable. If you add a tuner, especially if you add some compression, you are easily looking at another 8 to 10% on top of that. So, by far the biggest benefit of the S&S cam, sort of regardless of your configuration, is that the torque comes up quicker, even though it may be a little higher in the RPM range. When the torque comes on very quickly, and it will hold torque at a much higher RPM than the stock cam. The stock cam absolutely goes flat and starts to dive the torque up around probably 6,000 RPM or so. Where the S&S cam will hold it right on out in a free breathing motor, it'll hold the torque out past the original red line. So what does that really mean to me from a practical perspective, riding a motorcycle every day? you take a stock 650 and a 650 with air cleaner mufflers and a cam, put them both in third gear going down the road side by side, puttering along at 2500 RPM, and pin the throttles, the stock 650 might actually pull away a little bit for the first second or two, but when the cammed up 650 comes up on the cam at about 3500, 4000 RPM, that's all she wrote. She's gone. And that's the real difference.
Thank you so much for joining us for our talk all about camshafts. We hope you learned some stuff and that you enjoyed the video. Please comment, subscribe, share, all the usual stuff. And we wanted to let you know next week we're going to start talking about tuners. Tuners is a big topic. There's a lot of information. There's no way we can fit that into one video, but it'll all begin next week. And we promised you our big secret. So it may surprise you to discover that we don't actually keep spare engines around just to use as visual aids in YouTube videos. This engine is going to be a 965.
Yay! Now, before you start inundating the comments with questions, we want to tell you now, we're not answering them, right? We want to let you know we are in development on a 965 just because it's time for bigger and better things.
We've been doing 865s for over a year now. We've got 865s down. We're constantly improving and adjusting things and moving ahead. So this is moving ahead. This is the next step.
Yeah, so we've got cylinder heads, throttle bodies, lots of other stuff, and bigger and better is the next natural progression. So why are we building a 965 motor?
Because if you ain't having fun,
you're doing it wrong.